Have you ever sheepishly said, "It seemed like a good idea at the time"? Yes, it sounded like a good idea at the time, but it really was never a good idea at any time. All of us have made foolish mistakes. Like golfers who shank one into the woods, we would love to have a mulligan, a second chance to correct that first bad decision. We would be wise to have a better process to make decisions. Ask yourself, do I even know the process I use to make a decision? What kind of information and evidence do I need to make a decision? How many times do I let peer pressure play in my decision-making process? Are my emotions and "I want it now" feelings driving my decisions? We've all seen people, friends and family and coworkers, make really bad decisions. We wonder, how could somebody that smart make such a bad decision? And all those same people have seen us make less than spectacular decisions and wonder, how could somebody that smart make such a loser decision? For example, politicians who use their work phone to send inappropriate pictures and texts to someone they're not even married to. What were they thinking? The sheepish answer usually is, it seemed like a good idea at the time. So let's look at the Apostle Thomas, more popularly known as Doubting Thomas. What can we learn about being a disciple of Jesus Christ from this disciple, the disciple Thomas? First, I think a small decision can have lasting results is what we want to learn. Everyone knows that Thomas was a doubter. He didn't believe that Jesus was alive and that Christ had risen from the dead. One bad decision had given him the lasting adjective, Doubting Thomas. What was the bad decision? Simply this. He chose not to be with the disciples of Jesus after Christ's crucifixion. Thomas decided that being alone seemed like a good idea and a good decision rather than being with the other disciples of Jesus. Here's what it says in John chapter 20, verses 19 through 24. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. When things were bad, Thomas chose to isolate himself. If he had been with the other disciples when Jesus came the first time to see his disciples, then he would never have been called the doubter. How do you handle tough times and difficult problems? Do you run and hide, or do you seek out others to be with and to face the problems together? Lone Ranger Christians are everywhere, people who want to follow Christ by themselves and not be bothered by other disciples. Even during this COVID-19 health crisis, you can still stay connected to other Christians. The importance of Christian fellowship is given in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 24 through 25. It says this, "And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, and not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near." We need each other as fellow believers in Christ. Christians were never meant to be alone, but were meant for community, to be a part of God's family. What kind of family member would only want to be with their father and exclude everyone else? Think about a family reunion where you insisted that only you could come and be with your father. All the other brothers and sisters would have to come some other time. Excluding your siblings and ignoring them would not please your Father, much less your Heavenly Father. The Apostle Thomas neglected to meet together with his fellow disciples. In doing so, Thomas missed meeting Jesus. Sadly, one bad decision can lead to another. It's bad enough if we have a flat tire, but why would anyone go and slash the other three tires? One bad decision shouldn't lead us to more bad decisions. Thomas made a mistake, and he isolated himself. That was wrong. Now, when Thomas hears that he missed seeing the Lord Jesus risen from the dead, he decides that he doesn't believe it unless certain criteria were met. Thomas is living proof that if you tell people the paint is wet, they have to touch it to be sure. Thomas' second bad decision was not to believe his fellow disciples. You would think that after spending 3 years together, night and day, with the other disciples, he might have learned to trust these other disciples. Thomas doubted the witness of the disciples. Not a great start for the post-resurrection disciples who were to be Christ's witnesses to the whole world. Thomas decided to doubt, not just the fact that Jesus had risen from the dead, but also he doubted the testimony of 10 other men who said they saw the Lord Jesus alive and that Jesus was in their presence. Thomas wouldn't listen to what they said. How many times do we make a bad decision and then refuse to let someone give us good information that could correct our false understanding? He could have at least gone by the old axiom, trust but verify. Thomas could have believed the other disciples but wanted some additional proof. Instead, he forced them to overcome his biased decision. Happily, Jesus comes to the rescue. Here's the account in John chapter 20, beginning at the 25th verse. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hands and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." So a little over a week later, Jesus joins the disciples and gives a greeting of peace. Note that Jesus comes not to condemn, but to redeem humanity, including his disciples. Jesus gives that right relationship between God and humanity that Christ won by his death and resurrection. No longer are we separated and isolated from God because of our sin. We are in fellowship with our Heavenly Father for all eternity. That peace is also extended to doubting Thomas. Jesus is oh so merciful. He provides Thomas with the proof that Thomas demanded. Jesus urges him to move from disbelief and doubt to faith and trust. Thomas believed because of the tangible proof that Jesus gave him. Thomas saw with his own eyes that his Lord and Rabbi who was crucified was now alive, right in front of him. Then Jesus gives a blessing to all who believe without seeing. Jesus blesses those who believe the testimony of the eyewitnesses and the Word of God. Some people are prideful and unteachable in their demand for proof. No matter how much evidence you bring, they keep wanting more. We need to be careful to always point people to Jesus through the Word of God, the Bible. Often we want to cite other evidence than the testimony of Holy Scriptures. Jesus gives this important instruction in his parable of Lazarus and the rich man. A rich man was in torment in hell and is debating with Abraham in heaven. The rich man asks Abraham to send Lazarus back from the dead to tell the rich man's brothers to change their wicked ways. The rich man thinks that a resurrected Lazarus will convince his brothers. Abraham responds this way in Luke chapter 16, beginning at the 29th verse. But Abraham said, "They have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them." And he said, "No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent." He said to him, "If they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead." The religious leaders who crucified Jesus had more evidence than almost anyone else that Jesus was risen from the dead, yet they didn't believe. Thomas had the blessing of firsthand experience that Jesus was alive. We can learn from Thomas not to doubt, but believe that Jesus is alive and has paid for all our sins. You are greatly blessed by Jesus if you believe the testimony of the Holy Scriptures that Christ is risen. He is risen indeed.